Right.
All right, why don't we get started? It's a little after 4 o'clock. I'd like to welcome everyone. I'd like to welcome everyone to the September 16th, 2014 meeting of the Northampton Transportation Parking Commission. My name is Ryan O'Donnell. I'm the Ward 3 counselor and also the chair of the commission. And as is our custom, I'd like to go around the room and introduce ourselves for the benefit of the audience, starting with our Director of Planning and Sustainability.
Lee Pyden, Planning Director, and also for the record, I'm leaving at 4:30, so don't take it personally if you're in the middle of talking when I walk out.
Ned Huntley, Director of Public Works.
Elisa Klein, Ward 7 City Councilor.
Alex Bobby, Transportation Engineer.
Bill Hargreaves, Board of Health.
Gary Hartwell, Board of Public Works.
Devin Bruce, Planning Board.
Russ Sankwitz, Police Chief.
Rich Cooper, Citizen.
Okay. Well, thank you, and it seems there's a quorum, so I'll call the meeting to order. And the first thing I'll do is note that this meeting is being audio and video recorded. And we're also thankful to Mr. Hargreaves for taking minutes. If you're still willing to do that, this meeting, thank you very much. And before we begin going through our agenda, we start with public comment. I think many of you are here to talk about one of the two traffic calming applications. That's just a hunch, I could be wrong. But if you'd like to speak on any other subject at all, please feel free to come up. Oh, there might have been a sign-up sheet this time around.
Is that yeah, there is, actually. Up here.
Alex, could you mind grabbing that or something? Thank you.
I don't know if the other people that want to sign up.
Anyone else want to sign up?
Well, okay. Actually, we only have one person on it who is not going to speak on traffic calming. Unless Mr. Sass, you'd like to also speak on another matter before the traffic calming.
No, I know traffic calming.
Yeah. Okay, so Matt Gebert, you're up.
Oh, okay. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to speak. I came because I had noticed on the agenda that there was, Ryan had put the item talking about pedestrian safety on in the Montview area. And this is something that I worked on 5 years ago or so as part of the Ward 3 Traffic Calming Committee. And the issue's kind of come up again with, during that time, there's been a number of young families that have moved in the neighborhood. There's been an increase in pedestrian traffic. But there's still a very challenging intersection down there at the intersection of Henry Street and Venturers Field and Montview. And Town Farm has an access road there that has tractors and trucks and so forth coming in. And so you've got right now what is essentially a five-way intersection. And you also are in an area where one of the property owners is hoping to develop the property and get some townhouse units possibly in there once the infill question is resolved. So, there's been another kind of upwell of concern about the neighborhood, and Ryan took a tour with us recently, and we walked around and we talked about what had been done in the past. And one proposal that we had put forth at one point is to put in a small removable traffic circle there. We had worked with Laura Hansen back in the day when she was with us as traffic engineer for DPW, and this was one of her suggestions of things that we look into. And these are a traffic calming creation that, again, is removable when it's time to plow, or if for some other reason, there's going to be a bunch of big trucks coming through or something like that, it's possible to take them out. And anyway, since you brought up the issue, I came to just restate the fact that we have done some work on that in the past. I think there's still a neighborhood concern about it, but a lot of people in the neighborhood didn't hear about this agenda item until the last day or two. So I just wanted to put that out there as something that folks in the neighborhood think is a good idea to explore. Back when we looked into it in 2009, Laura gave us a website to look at. I sent it to you, I can't remember the name of the website, but it was gonna cost less than $800 to purchase one of these removable traffic circles. And we figured out with her help to install it would be, it would bring the price up to something like $1,200. So it's not like a huge investment. And also, if the city is looking at this as a possible strategy in other areas too, it seems to me at that price, it might not be a bad thing to buy one of these and just have to try in different areas. And that also reminds me that when we did the, went through the traffic calming process, which eventually led to speed humps on Williams and Holly, we put in temporary structures first to give the neighbors a chance to react to it. And then we had a follow-up meeting to see how people felt about it, and then it turned out that people liked having them and approved of it. Then the permanent ones went in, so that might be another advantage of having one of these movable ones that's not laid down permanently, because you might have a chance to essentially try it out with the public before it's installed permanently. So,
well, thank you very much, and I look forward to, we'll discuss this a little further amongst ourselves down in the discussion part of the agenda.
Great. Okay.
And also, it's not prohibited from coming back on a future agenda if other members of the community want to come.
Okay.
May I ask the name, your name and your...
Oh, yes. Mac Everett at 40 Valley Street.
Okay. Thank you.
Are there any other members of the public who'd like to speak on any subject? Okay. Well, then we'll move on and we'll start with approval of the minutes of August 19th. Would there be a motion to approve them? Oh, no, they're just around there. Is there a motion to approve the minutes from August?
So moved.
Ms. Bruce makes a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Anyone?
Second.
Mr. Hargrave seconds it. Thank you. Any discussion on the approval of the minutes? Any edits?
There is a typo on the first. It says minutes sore, August 19th.
Is that a Freudian typo? Were you feeling sore for having to take
it? No, I didn't type that.
Okay. Oh,
just so we know.
I guess I did. Well, that being noted and that correction being noted, any other discussion? Okay. All in favor? Opposed? Abstentions?
Abstain because I wasn't present.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much. We'll move on to reports from the committees. Do we have a representative from the parking committee here today who'd like to give a report? Polly Motta is the chair, and it doesn't appear she's here. So I suggest, unless anyone else would like to fill us in who might be on the parking committee, then we skip. But I think we can wait until next meeting to have her catch up. Bike and Ped Committee? I don't see Mr. Lowenthal, but Wayne.
We did have a quorum this morning, so we chatted, but it wasn't a formal meeting.
Okay. And transit, as always, nothing really.
Right, the new PVTA bus lines have started running, so that's good news.
Okay. Well, we made short work of that, so now we're on to number 7, updates from the DPW.
Robert Weiss Gypsy on Barron Street, completed last Friday. I think it was a success.
On Barrett Street.
Yeah, Barrett Street. And it's gonna open. Paving contract, mill and overlay segments completed, except bike lanes markings. They will be in place, should be this week. All depends on the weather. And signs, like the bike lanes, or share the road, hopefully it's should be in place by the end of next week. Reclaim of Sylvester Road should start next month, in the beginning of next month. That's pretty much it.
Okay, thank you. Any discussion or questions? Okay, thank you very much. We'll now move on to request an appointment session of our agenda, and we have two traffic calming applications that we've received. They just narrowly, one just narrowly beat out the other to be the first we've received this year. So that honor goes to Myrtle Street. And what I'd like to do is have anyone who'd like to speak on the issue of traffic calming on Myrtle Street to feel free to come up and start to do that.
Hello.
If you could state your name and address for the record.
So, Andrew Smith, 10 Myrtle Street, Northampton, Mass. So I got to do something I don't get to do very often. I got to take a late lunch and walk from my house downtown. And I got to appreciate the fact that there's all these people walking around, and I just want to sort of emphasize that my request doesn't have to do with the number of cars, it has to do with the speed of cars. Obviously, when you're walking around downtown, a lot of cars moving back and forth, but there's a lot of people and they don't go too fast. So Myrtle Street, it's a different situation for those who aren't familiar with the location of Myrtle Street. State Street, King Street, and then all the cross streets, there's Finn, there's Summer, and then Myrtle's right in between. We have there's an auto glass shop and Cumberland Farms. So the street itself is about 530 feet long. It's two-way street, and it's got sidewalks on each side, roughly two 11-foot travel lanes, and then two 5-foot sidewalks on either end. Parking is loosely enforced, for lack of a better term. There's some signs that have come down over the years. There's some no parking areas that don't really do what they're supposed to do in terms of keeping cars from parking on the road. But cars parking on the road are actually a good thing because it would, you know, slow the traffic down because it would make it nearer. But the problem right now is that because it's a cut through, obviously State Street, King Street, there's a lot of traffic going each one of those. As people are heading south on King Street, you know, they come to the underpass for Market Street, and they come to the downtown where the lanes come together. And there is a slight deceleration that occurs, and oftentimes people who are in a rush see Myrtle Street, which doesn't really have a lot of traffic on it, and they see it as an opportunity to jet through really quickly. So what you have is cars encountering a pretty open driving area. It's not really well defined. There's no fog lines, no speed limit, there's no center lines. And they say, got my straight shot. So they hit that, they go pretty fast, you know. 530-foot distance, people have traveled it, clocked it in about 7 to 10 seconds, so you're hitting 45, sometimes, you know, 55 miles an hour in speed downtown, which isn't very safe. And as you know, downtown, it's an older environment. Most of the houses were built in the 1870s, so they're really close to the road, sort of the old, you know, traditional built style. So there's not a lot of public space that people have that separates them from that traffic. So that's coupled with the fact that there's two traffic magnets on the street. You have the Cumberland Farms and you have the glass shop. The Cumberland Farms has, based upon ITE 8th edition, most 8th edition ITE, you're looking at 2,400 trips a day coming to that location. Again, it's not the number, it's the velocity. A lot of times people are in a rush. So, like I said, it's a cut through that people are trying to take advantage of. Personally, I've been verbally assaulted by people when I'm pulling into my driveway and pulling out of my driveway because they want to get where they want to go and they want to go fast. So I see this as a missed opportunity. It's right downtown. It's between two connector streets. It's near the bike path. There's opportunity to maybe do some traffic calming within the right-of-way. And I leave that to you guys to figure out. I think the opportunity exists. I think further study is definitely warranted. To address the situation that, you know, I've experienced and my neighbors have experienced too. I think we had 15 to 20 people sign a petition. And people have voiced concerns to me about, you know, they're pulling out of the driveways and people yell at them. They walk across the street and they don't feel safe because people are breezing through really quickly. And it's such a short street, you know, it's not one of the longer streets in town, but I feel like an investment of public dollars could be considered. I think you have a good impact in an immediate way in a short stretch of road that would be able to address the entire problem for the entire road, where sometimes you're addressing it piecemeal. I think this would be an opportunity to say, let's address this problem, let's do it all on this one road and be done for a long time. So I guess my petition is that the process be followed, that further study be taken to develop a solution to this particular case. That's my case, and I'm sure everybody else has their own case, and you have to balance those competing interests, but I feel like this is one that would merit further inquiry and further study.
Well, thank you for those comments. I think I probably got a little bit ahead of myself because I'd like to just explain briefly, judging by the audience, I think many of you know already, but what we're doing here is going through, well, the first traffic calming application that we've received from this commission this year, and when we receive those, there is a process that we go through. And this is the first step of the process. The Transportation and Parking Commission receives the application. And if it advances, well, the exact process, I'm sure we'll describe it as we go through both these traffic calming applications. But for anyone who's wondering what we're doing here, we're receiving the application and going through the first step of that process. So are there any questions for Mr. Smith from the commission about this application or any of his comments? Everything is pretty clear about. So, I mean, do you have a specific request, something that you're looking, a kind of a physical improvement to the street that you are looking for?
Well, I think that there are ways to, this is me speaking personally, I don't want to, you know, get in front of my neighbors on that, but I do think that there are ways to play with the right-of-way so it's not a straight shot. You definitely narrowing it down. Obviously, there's probably 10 to 20 different ways to do that. You could do, you could couple this with the recent stormwater authority, and you could do some right-of-way bioswales, rain gardens in the right-of-way, and there's no non-parking areas, so they're actually preventing people from going into the area. You can do some chicanes, which are really cool because you get to retrofit the right-of-way, and you could use those for street trees, and street trees are exciting, and everybody likes street trees these days. So that would be nice in those no parking areas. People talk about one-ways. I don't really have a feeling one way or the other on that. I think the main thing isn't really it's not really the number of cars, it's just the fact that they get to go fast. So anything in my mind that takes that right away, trims it down, makes people slow down, and establishes a human element on that street, from my perspective, would be good. So there's these two catch basins that are in the right-of-way that are down gradient. So water flows from State down to King. So potentially the opportunity exists to do some right-of-way bioswales in the area, which might be an interesting pilot project for the neighborhoods. Speaking as an abutting property owner, I personally wouldn't have any objection to that, and I can't speak for the people across the street from me, but this is one property owner who would not be opposed to something like that being tested out in front of this property. So I think that approach is something that I think would work, and I think that's something that would be exciting and fresh and new for the city to dig into.
Thank you. Are there any other comments from the audience or questions from the commission?
I was just going to ask if it's already, sorry I came in late, getting from class. Has it already been discussed, the possible relationship of Myrtle Street traffic calming project to State Street traffic calming project? Or has it not been discussed?
Not as such.
Then we should just mention that there is, among our list of traffic calming requests, the one for State Street, which I guess I maybe want to ask the DPW head if he thinks that it would make sense to consider them together or as separate projects.
I think the applications we might look at on State Street would be completely different than we would on Myrtle Street, since it's a very short, narrow street. I would suggest to the commission that we put down some traffic counters to start, just to see what the issues may be out there for vehicle classifications and speeds, and investigate accident data.
And I think, well, Mr. Lowenthal, just again by way of description, what you're getting at is when we receive these applications, we actually have a backlog of them because we really haven't. We've received, I don't know how many we've received over the past few years, 23, okay. And, you know, funding has been an issue in terms of moving forward, but when we go through the process of doing studies after we receive these applications, it's part of essentially ranking these applications in terms of when we should do them. Is that kind of a fair description? And so when Mr. Lowenthal talks about the State Street traffic calming application, that's an existing one that came in at some point in the past that is also kind of sitting there in the wings. That's an accurate description, you know? Okay. So now I guess the first step for us is to do what you suggest and consider moving forward with an analysis.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And that is the first step for this application and for all applications. Okay, again, this is my first application. All right.
And then
then how many traffic counters could you run at the same time? Because I feel like if we do something on that street, it's, you know, cars are like water. They're just going to go to the other cut-throughs between State and King. So I'm wondering if we have a way to get some base counts now so that we would know that if we traffic calmed Myrtle, you know, that we increase the traffic on one of the other streets that goes through.
We have four traffic counters now.
Would that make any, you could do it relatively at the same season next week kind of thing and get what I'm after, but you know what I'm thinking is just...
We were limited to two before until about 2 months ago. Or so we bought two more traffic counters so we could work at various, you know, street-legged intersections like Ryan and Florence Road.
Yeah. I don't feel strongly about it, I'll just let you decide, but I mean, I foresee that if you slowed down traffic on that street and not, and didn't do anything on the other street, it's just gonna flow there instead.
Does a traffic counter do speed also? Are you?
They do speed, they do vehicle classification. Cars, tractor trailer trucks, buses.
Any other questions? What is the length of the study you would do? What period of time would you study?
For traffic counters, we usually put it on for 1 week. With the construction going on right now, it might take a month or 2 months.
So you would study a 2 month period?
No, I would study for...
You would start in...
Yeah.
It's the time to get them out there, and you have to do it before freezing conditions.
Okay.
So we can make every attempt to have it done for maybe by mid-November.
Right. All right, and then, so in terms of the process, this study is done, and then what is the next step after that? It returns to this commission?
It would come back with some data and a presentation as to what issues we found out there.
Any other comments? All right. Well, then someone can make that motion, I think, to recommend the DPW start that study.
Is that not an automatic process with the submission of the application?
It's not automatic because, you know, one of the things on this application is, for example, signatures from neighbors. So we could look at it as a commission, this is my understanding of the application process, we could look at it and say, well, there's no support in the neighborhood, so why would we even go through a study?
We also had, I think, just one where we just sort of didn't believe was a problem. The traffic was a dead-end curve street in Ward 6, so we just said it's not worth coming forward, so we're not wasting everybody's time, so it's not needed.
So that would be my preference anyway, that the commission actually make a recommendation to either proceed or not to proceed with this application based on the merits of what we heard so far. And if so, then I would ask, it would be good if the DPW would do this analysis, but if we don't think it is merits, we don't want to do it.
I feel comfortable making a recommendation that the DPW collect some data, but that's what I want to have in front of me before we decide whether we approve a traffic common project.
Absolutely.
Just clarifying, those are two separate things.
Yep. Right. Voting to collect the data is not the same as approving the application.
I move that we launch a data collection project on Myrtle.
Second.
Sounds so good when you say it. Any discussion? Okay. All.
Oh, who was the second?
No. Oh.
James.
Okay. So first and second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Okay.
Can I ask a quick question about the data collection process? I thought I should have done that during the voting. So would that just be the ends of Myrtle Street, or would it take into consideration King and State as well to account for turning? Or is it just on that street exclusively, or would it be a broader scope to try to figure out where
on that street itself at this point?
Okay, good enough.
Because you're not able, because doing turning motions requires a person to stand out there and record.
No, we just have to have enough meters to go around.
All right, thank you.
It's going to be a lot of heavy equipment on your lawn.
That's okay.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll now move on to another traffic calming application. This one is for Chestnut Street. And I think we can do it much like we just did the other and start with public comment. Anyone who'd like to speak on this application? Mr. Sass.
John Sass, 131 Chestnut. It's going to be very similar to Myrtle Street, except that it's a longer street, probably has more traffic. I don't know if people go 55, that seems a stretch, but we do have a lot of traffic. I'm a recent resident there. I live on Sheffield Lane, which is a nice quiet street up a little bit, a couple blocks away. And it sort of took me back a little bit to see how much traffic Chestnut has. And it's especially a little troubling because we do have nice sidewalks, at least to a point. There's one sidewalk on one whole side, and then there's another one that ends at some point, which is an issue, because it just sort of ends and there's no crosswalk from that point. But there are children on the street, young kids who like to play, and like my neighbor just sends their kids across the street, and that's a little concerning. But a lot of people walk on the street, and so it's a real neighborhood, which is very nice. But we do have a lot of cars going through. It is a cut through, I guess, from Bridge Road to Main Street. Cooper's is a nice destination for a lot of people, which is very nice at the end of the street. It was interesting, the police had set up, I believe it was the police had set a radar machine up a couple houses down from my house, and we were watching the traffic go by. And it wasn't as fast as I had thought it was, but that was while the construction of Chestnut was still going on. So a few houses down, the pavement ended. And so I think we weren't seeing the real data collection. I don't know what the results were, but it seems like there's a lot of cars. And the same thing as Myrtle. It's a wide enough street. There's no lines on it. It does say 30 miles an hour. And people can sort of fly down the street. And a lot of people do that, especially in the morning, rush hour times, morning and afternoon. And that's, you know, kids are out going to school. And that's just a real concern. I know we had started this conversation a couple months ago, and just after we had talked about it, there was an accident on the bike path, which crosses Chestnut Street. And we had talked about maybe doing something like Smith did, which was raise the bike path up over the pavement. But then we found out that the city was already in the process of redoing Chestnut. It was too late to do that, which was too bad, because that might have been a nice way to slow people down, at least on the bike path. But High Street's an intersection that always seems a little dangerous. And when Strawberry Hill comes down, people don't even see that intersection as they go by. So it's always a concern that something might happen. So it is a concern of a neighborhood. There's a number of us here. And we hope that the city looks at trying to figure out a way maybe to either slow traffic down or get people to use it a little more careful way.
Thank you very much. Any questions?
The question that we posed earlier, or that was answered for us, was the volume versus speed. And it sounds like on Chestnut, from what I know, because I actually use Chestnut quite a bit myself, it seems like you have both problems. Is that true?
That's my opinion. I don't know, neighborhood people can say. So there we go. Yeah, I'd say both. I'm not sure. The thing about volume, though, is if you make it harder for people to take Chestnut, they're going to go somewhere else. So North Maple becomes an issue, though. And I don't know what the issues for North Maple are. But for us, it's a neighborhood. It's a residential street with lots of people. And it's a lot of traffic. So we're hoping the city can think about how to make that better for us.
Is your application for between Main Street and Bridge Road, or from Pine Street to Bridge Road?
Oh, that's an interesting question. I was thinking Main Street, but is that what it did? To Main Street. Yeah, across the street. That's a good question.
Is there a specific location that you're interested in, like next to High Street or closer to Bridge Road?
Well, it depends on the traffic calming. If you were thinking about doing a little circle, like Mac was talking about, a little portable circle at High Street to slow people at that intersection, that would be specific, or Strawberry Hill. Otherwise, we're talking about just slowing people down in general, going down the street.
Other questions? Okay. Thank you very much.
Sure.
And would anyone else like to put in 2 cents? Del Penna is here.
Sorry, I'm late.
No, please.
I think what we propose would be three things to look at here. a raised crossing of the rail trail that would definitely slow down cars, not a ghost raised crossing as we see in some places around the city. But we'd like to see one like Route 9 at Amherst College for this professional grade raised crossing. And since there's four quadrant sewer, storm sewer grates there, this would work perfectly. And that would definitely slow traffic down. And the second item we'd like to have considered would be a four-way stop sign at Chestnut and High Street. Because particularly traffic coming from Bridge Road in the morning, when Florence Savings Bank employees come down the street and then they turn right onto High and head north to get to their parking lot, it's a problem because in that directional alignment, it's a very, very poor sight line there. And we think a way to solve that would be a four-way stop sign, or alternatively to cut the grade down further down the street, and that would be problematic for a host of reasons. But a four-way stop sign would probably work. And the third thing would be the disconnection of the sidewalk network there. And there may be a mid-block crossing from the north side to the south side of Chestnut Street, near where Mr. Sass lives, where they see this problem of a natural tendency for people to want to continue walking, but the sidewalks end. And so to cross the street, there should be a proper crossing. That's a beautiful, professional grade sidewalk and crosswalk alignment was just painted on our streets in the last couple of weeks. And so we'd like to see that continue. So that's it. There's more people here, I think, should speak a little bit. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. That's a challenge to me. Is that what I want to take him up on? Don't respond to a bully.
Let myself be pushed around. Joanne Weber, 84 Chestnut Street. Have the pleasure of living on the corner of Chestnut and High, so we can, and being retired, spending a lot of time at that location, we can hear the brakes. We can hear the brakes start squealing, probably on the order of average two a day, and the horns. My interpretation of what's happening there is that the people on High, who are using it to bypass the main street of Florence with its three traffic lights, that traffic has increased dramatically on High because of possibly that very road construction that seemed to destroy the test on volume on Chestnut. Tremendous amount of traffic going that way, and people, I believe, as they slow for their stop sign, presume it's a four-way. And I think what is causing that is the people on Chestnut who take it frequently know that that corner is very dangerous and there's two or three squeals per day, and they slow down as they approach Chestnut and High. So the people on High think, okay, it is a four-way stop, and they start to move, and that's when you get, you know, the near collisions. We were almost clipped about 10 days ago ourselves. That was a woman on her telephone, but who was going right through the stop sign. I cannot explain all the variations of what goes wrong there, but it goes wrong fairly frequently, and it took out one of my small gardens once. I'm expecting that if the minimum that you can do is a paint job, the northeast corner is the bus stop for grade school children. To put crosswalks painted around Chestnut and High might contribute the thought that it is a four-way stop. More people might slow as they approach it, and they'll work it out themselves. There is another mentality that goes very fast. They slowed up for the bike trail, and now they're just bombing through because they have the right to do that. I don't know how to explain it, except I think people think in their heads that it's a four-way stop. They're up to judging what the other driver is going to do. If that makes any sense to you.
Oh, thank you very much. Any questions for Ms. Weber? Anyone else like to give some comment? Please, if you can give your name and address for the record.
Yes, my name is Ida Liebert, and I live at 47 Chestnut Street. And if you're not familiar with that road, I live almost across from Cooper's Supermarket. So that's intersections, as everybody knows, is pretty crazy. So I think it is both a problem of volume and speed. But what I see there, and I've almost been run down more than once trying to cross from my house over to Cooper's, is a lot of times there's delivery trucks in front of Cooper's, which they have to be, it's a necessity. But there'll be somebody coming from the bridge and Chestnut, not barreling down the road, and they'll be trying to get around the truck. And then there's somebody coming, turning left off of Main Street, trying to come down Chestnut. And I've seen it, you know, there'll be one person coming one way and one the other, and because the delivery truck is blocking the visibility. But, you know, they really do, it seems to me, speed up after they cross. If they're coming from Bridge Street, they tend to speed up after they cross the bike path. When there's only that really short distance from the bike path to Main Street. So if, I guess if you aren't familiar with that road, you might not be able to envision that. But then going the other way, I think it's a long stretch to Bridge Street, and I think that's pretty busy. People tend to speed up on that one too, but I must say that corner, from the corner to the bike path is pretty treacherous there. Everyone walks that street, kids on skateboards, bikers. I mean, it's heavily, heavy pedestrian section through there. So if there's anything you can do to accelerate process, please do.
How about Mr. Last name? Could you spell it, please?
Liebert, L-I-E-B-E-R-T.
Thank you.
And I've lived there 4 years, so I'm a relative newcomer, but.
Well, thank you very much for your comments. Any other questions? Ms. Liebert?
I have a quick question. Does it appear that people are speeding up in that last stretch that you were talking about because they're trying to race for the light, the change in the
Yeah, road? And I mean, I have a tendency to do that myself. I back out of my driveway and I think, oh, I can beat that light. And that may be why they're speeding. It is a short light, so maybe that would account for some of the speeding up right
now. We don't normally take questions in the audience, but we can.
Well, it's not a question. I just want to add to that, because that's, I hadn't thought about that, but that's exactly what happens, is that light has a pressure light. I don't know what you call it, but if someone's waiting there, it takes a while, but eventually it turns green. If they're the only car there, it lasts like 5 seconds, and then it turns red again. So I think people know that. So if they see a light turn green, they do race, and I've seen that, where people speed up to get through that light. I don't know if that can be fixed or if that's an okay thing. Sorry.
No, not at all. Okay. That's fine. That's helpful information. Thank you. Any other questions for Ms. Liebert? No. It sounds like we should really repeal Cooper's Corner's business license, though. I don't know if we get unanimous vote on that. For the record, that was a joke. In fact, I move we strike that from the record. Okay, any other? Oh, Mr. Hargreaves.
Could Alex or Matt explain the warrants required for a four-way stop?
That's a really good idea. I think that'd be great.
As I presented, I believe like 2 or 3 months ago, it has to be, I believe, 5 accidents in 1 year. Or on main road, 300 vehicles per hour, and minor road, 200 vehicles per hour. And that's all what I can remember right now.
Is there anything about the relative traffic volumes on the two legs or four legs?
which is...
That's what we just had, he had the volumes on the main road, which would be Chestnut Street and the side streets, just meeting so many vehicles.
Oh, oh, that's what you're saying, I see. I understand.
So, pretty much minor roads, they won't meet the warrant.
Chestnut Street would be considered a minor road.
No, the crossing is a minor.
Christ, okay. Is there a consideration for vehicle classification?
No.
That's a question I would have for residents. Is there truck traffic as well as cars?
All about the truck.
Oh, no. That must have been an illusion. Yes, there are trucks, but we need Coopers.
Who escaped this time?
We rely. You could make Chestnut a dead end that ends at Cooper's parking lot. That's fine. That would be okay. Yes, there are trucks. And what I don't understand are the trucks that are coming along high. I think they're trying to avoid the lights once again through Florence. But there are very large trucks that come on high and turn toward Bridge Road, and they also turn toward Coop. We can just set up a movie camera from our house and you can see what we see. It's really quite amazing. There's a very, very large truck that could barely make that corner.
Okay.
24-wheeler.
Okay. Mr. Coop.
Just a clarification to Ned or Alex. So the warrant means in order to meet state standards? Is that right? So a municipality can't just erect four-way stops wherever
they
want?
They can't.
So there's nothing to do with state funding. It's a matter of that you cannot do it.
Engineering criteria is
interesting. And a related question, which might be educational, is my understanding is the stop sign is not normally part of our traffic calming application process. Is that correct? That's not a result that we might get from, strictly speaking, this application.
Right. Maybe an end result from our findings, what we do find, but
okay.
Initially they'll go out there to look for a multi-way stop.
Okay. And would anyone else like to give comment? Okay. Mr. Delpenny, you want to double dip?
Yes, I know that.
Please come on up and.
I know that the terminology is called average daily trips. The key word there is daily. And you're talking hourly. I've never heard in the context of transportation policy that there's a benchmark for hourly trips on some kind. It is.
Has to do with traffic signals, multi-way stops.
Well, are those hourly trips only during the daylight hours?
Eight hour span.
I know that all the DOTs in the United States have a hidden page, or at least not easily findable page, of all the average daily trips for communities, of all the busier roads in the communities, not just state numbered roads. Is there a page on the City of Northampton website that has this hourly benchmark out there? Where is this from?
We don't have that kind of data. Not hourly for every street. We have information that we get from Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. We have information we get from MassDOT. We have information that we collect. But not every street is classified what we have from information.
All right. Because I never heard that hourly basis before. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Any other public comment on this traffic calming application? Okay. Is there any further discussion in the commission?
I would just say we follow as we have our process before and request that the DPW set up monitoring for speed and volume in a particular area that was identified by the speakers and bring the data back to us for examination of potential solutions.
I agree, and I just want to recognize, I didn't see it in the traffic calming application, but maybe it is here. I know that this issue is a long-standing one on Chestnut Street, and that the last time it was paved, I know that residents were already discussing this. So I'm afraid, according to the official rules, you're not going to get points for having waited all this time after your application was submitted 10 years ago, the way others do. But I just wanted, for the record, to acknowledge that, in fact, the issue was raised a long time ago.
Is that a second?
Yes.
Chief makes a motion, Mr. Blumenfeld seconds.
There's only chief.
Any other discussion? That's okay with the DPW?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Well, I suggest we vote on the recommendation just to be official about it. So, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Okay, thank you. And thank you to everyone who came today to provide your public comment on this application. And we'll be in, you can certainly be in touch with me going forward if you have questions about the process in the future. So with that, we'll move on now down the agenda to orders and ordinances. We have one that you have in front of you. This is an ordinance to really set and effectively increase the fine for illegally parking in a handicapped parking space. This is an idea that was brought by Nancy Forrestal last meeting we had, and I, along with Councilor Klein, went and wrote it up as an ordinance. It was referred from the City Council to our committee, as well as the Ordinance Committee, and it's here in front of you. The ordinance sets a new amount at $150 for parking legally in a handicapped parking space, and I would like to open it up for discussion, and maybe it would be first appropriate to recognize Ms. Forrestal to see if you would like to make any comment in addition to what you said last meeting. You certainly don't have to.
No, okay. I think the information was presented.
Well, I would like to just, before we get into, I would like to have a discussion on this because I think it's important that we deliberate carefully on what the actual fine amount is. I put $150, but that's just because I put $150. I think we have to be thoughtful and set a fine that is the right amount. And I'm happy to read what Ms. Forrestal told us last time about other communities. Amherst has theirs set at $200, Westfield $200, Holyoke $300, Springfield $150, Chicopee $100. East Hampton and Hadley are both $50, which, strictly speaking, are out of step with Mass General Law, which the minimum set by Mass General Law is 100. Boston is between $100 and $120. Greenfield is $200, and South Hadley is 100. And so we effectively now have a $100 fine, which again we don't codify for some reason. It's been administratively decided. But as I look through the code of ordinances, I don't see the dollar figure there. So that would be an additional advantage of having this ordinance, is we could actually put it into the code, which is where it really should be. But that's what surrounding communities do, so we're low by that standard a little bit.
I'm sorry I wasn't here last month, but I thought at one point we set it to match the state. I hear you say the state is a minimum of 100.
It's a range of 100 to 3.
It was 1 to 3.
Okay, so we have the authority to set it between. Okay.
Right. It went up a few years ago.
Yeah, and I think at that time we changed it to match the state law, so we wouldn't have to go back and change it every time.
And now you have the right to put it within that range.
Just want to make sure.
Okay, great.
I'm sure you did your research correctly, but I had to check.
The parking committee
isn't here, but
this?
And Wayne wasn't there last week at our meeting, but I just want to say that we looked at it and we all voted favorably.
You did?
Yes. You wouldn't have that because the minutes aren't out yet, and Wayne wasn't.
Was there any discussion about
about whether it was too high or too low or just right, and people thought that the research had been done and that they would affirm it.
Great, thank you. I appreciate that information. The parking committee applied the Goldilocks test, apparently. any other discussion among Commission? Please.
Wondering, Nancy, if you could remind us, did you make a recommendation to us of what you would like to see it raised to?
No, I didn't. I thought that that was the TPC's.
So you don't want to share a recommended amount with us now either?
What I would like to say is that this is a widespread problem, abuse of the handicapped parking violation across the state. That we, meaning parking enforcement, runs into people misusing, abusing the handicapped placard use and also parking in handicapped spots. It's increasing each year. And frankly, with the baby boomer generation, there will be more and more people who will be in need of these spaces. So we need to make the enforcement count.
I was curious, Nancy, while you're still there. Do you have statistics of how many fines or how many tickets are issued for violations?
A year, roughly.
You're
in
Northampton?
Yeah.
I did present that
the
last time, so I hope that I have it with me now.
At least in our minutes.
It might be in the minutes.
In our collection, as you did it from the first of the year until present.
Right.
It was around 45?
I think it was 45 to 50 of them.
The meeting minutes from last time said since January 2014, 35 tickets were issued and 25 handicap stickers were seized for alteration.
So, is that a lot?
That's just here. And that is just mainly in the downtown business district.
That's just PDOs.
That's
not the, all the ones my folks can
bring. Right, no, it's not the $500 ones that your folks can do.
Which we do a lot of in the Walmart lots, the
yeah.
All the others,
right.
Probably daily.
What's the fine that you impose? The police?
Well, there's a $100 parking
right.
violation, and then the police department has the authority to write a $500 ticket
for misuse of a handicap packing.
Right.
Parking placard. And there's a fair amount of people that.
Right. And then I also send packets to the registry with the information on what the situation was and request that they review it and have a hearing within the registry. And they have the right then to take action against the person's license.
Thank you.
Is there a reason why the NPD versus the PEOs have different dollar authorities to write fines to?
No, it's $100 for the parking, which we're increasing to $150. $500 is an abuse of the placard.
But the PEOs don't write that $500 fine, only the police officer can?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, the jurisdiction is for municipal police. Officers are the most police. I believe you've heard it all. My mother's handicapped, so I used your placard to drive to CVS to park in the handicapped space, therefore I'm entitled. No.
and like I discussed last month, it has gotten to the point where we seized a handicapped placard that was being used by the child of a deceased person. He was using his mother's placard so that he could deliver food more conveniently, pick up and deliver food more conveniently in his job. So, I mean, that's how it was just out there.
Mr. Cooper, would you go?
Yes, I just had a that somewhat cleared it up. So this is not just the violations of someone parking in a handicapped spot who did not have a placard. These are misuse of placards. And how do I identify that? The placard has a person's name
the,
on it?
The PEOs have been outstanding in being very observant, looking at the placard that's being displayed, looking to see if it's been altered. Is it expired? The person's picture is covered, but it often will get to the point where they might hang around the area, watch a person approaching the vehicle, ask to, could they take a look at the placard, to see the expiration date, find out this thing's been altered. It's not the person who's actually with the vehicle at the time. A lot of them are being altered, a lot of them.
But just for clarification, our ordinance would only be a fine for the actual parking in the space.
Parking.
When you find a fraudulent or potentially fraudulent placard, the state essentially sends out that fine or goes to that process. With
what basically is happening is we're writing a ticket,
okay,
even if it's, you know, it's altered, but that's for not having a current valid placard to park in that space.
Okay.
Then we would call the police department over to see if they were in a position to be able to issue that $500 ticket.
Okay.
Above and beyond that. And then that packet I would additionally send to the registry and ask that they review it for additional action.
Okay, thank you.
And these are all towable.
Pardon?
These are all towable fines. So offenders can also be towed.
Towable, okay.
Right.
I'm surprised that the misuse of placards is higher than I had any thought of.
It is very widespread. And it's not just people saying, I was only going to run in for a second. It's people who are making a conscious effort to alter a placard so that they can use it.
Just a point of information. So all fines collected, whether by the police department or by the park enforcement officers, belong to the city, or do some go to the state?
No, they're all. Park enforcement have a computerized system, so their data collection is much better. We still use the manual handwritten tickets. So when the book gets used up, we send them over. So they don't necessarily get compiled into the numbers.
Well, no, we're compiling them in.
Right, for the totality of the offenses. But all the site violations go, parking go to town.
Right, that goes to the Commission on Discipline.
So even a $500 fine, which is essentially not a parking fine, but it's a fine for altering a state document or something, that's that money stays in Northampton.
50% of it.
That's a state, right. That's a state law that allows us to. We get half of that because it's a Mass General law. Anything that's written under city ordinance is city money. And you're right, there is that. Some of the money goes to Disability Commission.
Right. The parking ticket, 100% of that goes to the Disability Commission.
Right.
In the city. And can be used as is seen fit by that commission.
Any other thoughts or discussion?
Motion to recommend.
Okay, Chief makes a motion to recommend. Mr. Cooper seconds. Any discussion on the motion to recommend this as written with $150 to the City Council and the Ordinance Committee?
Aye.
Mr. Harper.
I'm in favor. Are we voting? Or are we?
Oh, well, now we can vote. All
right.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. All right. Thank you very much. Okay, and now we're into all of our discussion items. Let's see if we can move some up based on people who are here patiently waiting. Chris Mason is here. Chris, would you like to lead us through the discussion of retrofitting lamp posts?
Be glad to.
Okay.
Thank you.
This agenda item, for the record, is number three of the discussion items, replacement and retrofitting of lampposts in certain city streets and parking lots to incorporate energy-efficient LEDs.
Okay, I'm not going to start off with it. Yeah. This is a, hand these out first, and then I'll start off. I don't have enough for everybody. I wasn't sure how many folks would be here, and I'm trying to save paper. So I'm here looking for advice, direction, possibly a recommendation. It's a topic that can kind of get complicated quickly, so I've tried to organize it as direct to what the decision points are as possible, and try to bring it up that way. So the city has received a grant of $126,506 to retrofit 156 of our ornamental post-op lights to LEDs. And what I passed out there was a map showing the locations of all the retrofits. And on the back side of that, you'll see we had three different lighting experts, two of them who work with utilities, one of them an independent one, who all recommended the same, they call it a light engine. So it's not a lamp. So what we're talking about is basically replacing bulbs. Only it's not a bulb, so it's called a light engine. So you can see it on the back. And for most of the lights, that's what everybody recommended. The retrofit, if it's completed with that fixture right there, would save the city about $12,000 to $13,000 a year in energy costs. So it would cut down the energy use by the lights by about 75%. When James Lowenthal, Mr. Lowenthal heard about this, he had some topics he wanted to bring up. I've met with him, we've walked around and looked at some of the lights, and in essence, basically, the city could possibly do better than this if it's willing to expand the parameters. And this is where it kind of gets beyond the decision making of my office. Right now, if we we could possibly go from reduced uplighting. You'll notice that light engine that you're looking at, all the LEDs are sitting in the top, pointing down. And so what that means is that instead of having a bulb that shines in all directions, this shines predominantly down. It shines about 93%, I think it's by spec, about 93% down, about 7% leaks up. And as Mr. Lowenthal has pointed out, if you put that into a current fixture, because the lens is around this, then the lens will absorb and re-reflect the light, and so you still have some uplighting. There's two sample lights down by La Florentina, one in the two different fixtures that have sample lights. And so it definitely reduces the uplight. This fixture definitely reduces the uplight, but it's not 100% cut off. And none of our ornamental lights are 100% cut off there. They all predate the dark sky ordinance. Another advantage of going, if instead of replacing the bulb, we actually bought a fixture that was LED compliant, or you know, meant for LEDs. LEDs, the lifetime of an LED can be degraded if it gets too hot. So you'll notice that one here has a whole bunch of heat sinks on the top, little fins to kind of let the air, you know, let the light cool down. But I'm putting it into a fixture that wasn't designed for an LED. So will the fixture build up too much heat? Will it degrade? When we wrote the grant, we decided to take a chance on that. The fixtures actually, quite frankly, are kind of leaky. We felt we could get away with it. Grant money, we're not really putting our money on the line, so if it, it degrades. But if you went with a fixture that actually was built, designed for an LED, then it's gonna be designed to have the thermal cooling needed. And you'll probably get a better warranty, and you reduce the risk of having a shorter lifetime lamp. I can't tell you how much. I mean, I think this one might just last a long time, but I really don't know. And by widening up the options that we look at, we might actually be able to go to a lower wattage bulb. 75% reduction is a pretty big reduction. So any lower wattage is gonna be tweaking that. It's not gonna be a huge additional savings. I've kind of calculated that at a couple of them, and it's not gonna save us that much more money, but we possibly might save a little bit more money and a little bit less energy. So the topic comes down to, I've got two primary questions that I want to have the commission weigh in on. Would the commission support changing the style of post-top lamps? The thing is, if we want to get to 100% cutoff, and we want something designed for this, then the style of lamps that are out there right now, and what I'm talking about, if anybody, see if, you look out that window, you can see at the end of the rows, there's little kind of square. Where can we see them?
There's an acorn right there.
Right, so there's some acorn ones you can see right here. Yeah, they're kind of, I call them acorn because they have this kind of like little top with little fringe around the outside. It looks like an acorn top. The other kind I call colonial, that's the other predominant one. It's a little square one. Looks like an old gas lamp, but it's a square-sided fixture. They're down at the end of the rows down there. So, let's see if I missed anything here. Nope. So towards that,
One last thing I'll say is that in order to get a utility rebate, and it could be a substantial rebate, these lights have to be on what's known as the Design Light Consortium Qualified Product List. And the reason why is that LEDs, when they first came out, were seen as not lasting as long as advertised, not having the light outputs that they advertised. Utilities weren't certainly willing to give a rebate for something that wasn't what it says it was. And so the Design Light Consortium, when they started looking at the lights, when they found one that was out of spec, they would go back to the manufacturers. The manufacturers were very often willing to redo how they do their manufacturing in order to meet the spec. So if you buy a light for your house, put it inside whatever, you probably want to make sure it's on the Design Light Consortium's list, or it's qualified as Energy Star lights. Both of those being, they've been looked at. Someone's actually tested the bulbs. But for us to get a rebate, and it's a significant rebate for this, it has to be on that list. So what I've just passed out is I have looked on the Design Light Consortium's list, and I have found every post-top, ornamental post-top lamp that fits some basic parameters. I didn't look for any that would be really higher wattage. We don't want to go higher wattage. I tried looking for ones that actually had a warmer color to them, if at all possible, but that whole list is there. And those are the kind of styles we're talking about. A lot of them no longer have glass on the sides. The LEDs are mounted up into the inside the top of the light, and the glass is up there, and so the LEDs shine down. And a lot of these are 100% cut off, but they're definitely a different style. So that goes beyond my office, and I don't know if it even sits with the Transportation Commission. Oh, I should say, the reason I'm bringing this to the Transportation and Parking Commission is because a lot of these lights, not all of them, but a big number of these lights are in parking lots or along streets with street side parking. So they're really kind of meant for pedestrian parking situations. So I thought this would be a time to bring up. And I guess I'll go through the rest of my questions before I ask for discussion. But so the second big question is, would the commission support a reduced lighting level in any of the ornamental post-top lamp locations? I bring that up because both because that could actually save us some more energy if we're willing to go to a lower wattage bulb, but also because Mr. Lowenthal had brought up a desire to have a warmer light. And the tendency, it's not 100%, there are some lights, but the tendency is for when you go from a what they call a cool white light, and the one that we've been recommended is more in the middle, but it's probably slightly on the cooler side. It's not anywhere near the bluest lights you can get out there. They have kind of a bluest hint if they're on the cool side, or a yellow hint if they're on the other side. In order to get to a warm white light, the lights actually get less efficient. And so if you maintain the same lumens output, you're going to have to use more wattage. Or you go down to a lower, you stay with some, about the same wattage, and you go down to a lower lumen output. So, and trying to quantify that makes some sense of that. I have one last handout for everybody. Find my hand up. Yeah, where'd the last one go? I didn't hand them out already, did I?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry, this is looking right out. Again, I've only six copies each. Three on that side, three to share on this side. Like I said, this gets complicated. It can get complicated really fast. So I'm trying to break it down and make it as straightforward as possible. What you're looking at is the way the eye sees during daylight hours or in office conditions like this. It's called photopic. So your eye, certain parts of your eye work and they see with photopic. When you get into really dusk, I mean, it's dark out, no lights out, moonlight, basic. It's called scotopic. And different spectrum lights allow your eyes to see differently. So some, and in some cases, it gets a certain spectrum light, you actually will see it as brighter in scotopic than comparative to another kind of light. What we're talking about at street light level is called mesopic, and that's kind of a combination. Your eyes are both in this kind of halfway transition phase. So what I have here, none of these lights are what we actually have. I don't have specs for this specialist, but this is based off of typical lights. So you see on the bottom, I have a couple of kind of made up LEDs, whether it's a cool white light, so 5500K LED, or a warm white LED. And then the ones to the right of that are all the types of bulbs we have around the city. And you'll notice I broke them into three categories. The far right, the far the last four columns, they're all pretty low outputs. And so those I'm actually going to kind of set aside because we've looked at it, and no matter what the lighting folks recommended, this 55 watt LED, inside we feel comfortable going with a lower wattage and with a lower light output. Because I look at what's actually there and it's low, so it's near dim. And that would be where you're going to find that is Pulaski Park, around James House, and around at Forbes Library. Those three locations in particular already have dim lights, and so I don't see any reason to go any brighter. The ones that have MH, like 175 watt MH, 150 watt MH, that's a metal halide, and those you notice that the actual lumens are low, but they look really bright. So the left column, the photopic, it's actually not that bright of a, I mean, the lumens are kind of halfway up the chart, but the mesopic lumens, the way it looks to you, is really a lot brighter. And that's actually what metal halides are used for. It's because they have what will look like a white light, actually kind of a white bluish light. And people just report being able to see a lot better underneath them. And where those are located, and I can't say for sure, I do know that Bill Attender at one point was getting complaints for people from women that were in the Roundhouse parking lot. They felt it wasn't safe out there. And so he went with a higher luminosity and the metal halide in order to get kind of a white light, and they felt more comfortable being in the yard. So when I look at where these are placed, they're at the bike paths, they're at the Roundhouse lot, they're in the Strong Street lot, I suspect that's why we have those lights, the metal halide lights in those areas. I suspect those are places where they were really meant to provide a feeling of safety. And the if you look at the two sample LEDs, the lumen output that I've calculated these on are that's the lumen output that the LED retrofit was recommended. So we can kind of expect that the mesopic lumens are going to look about that mid-range here. So it's going to be somewhere in here. It's probably going to be more on the upper side because it is a little bit on it's a 5,000 K LED, so it's probably going to be more on that side over there. That's not as high as what we already have in the in those lights out there that the ones where we have the metal halides on. That's possibly going to look a little dimmer. I couldn't really tell you, but it's possibly going to look a little bit dimmer. On the other hand, all of these acorn ones that we have, acorn tops, those are high pressure sodium, which is a very yellow light. And you'll notice that the lumens that they put out, their left bar, are way up top. So that's the photopic number of lumens. That's what you would measure, lumens output. But they look a lot dimmer because our eyes, yellow light just doesn't provide the light color that we need to really be able to make things out. So they look a lot dimmer. When the night that we were walking around, Ms. Molotov took a picture of the yellowish high pressure sodium light right down by La Florentina with the sample LED retrofit into it. And if you look at them, I would say that it actually kind of fits this. The white LED looks just a little bit brighter. I don't know, Jane, do you have that picture available?
I do.
Okay. I don't know if we can hold it up or...
Ideally, I'd like to project it, but I didn't understand that there wasn't going to be a computer waiting for me.
There was briefly, but the computer left because it was feeling sick. So
I have all these. I have all these pictures that are going to illustrate everything Chris is saying. But without a computer, I can't.
Unfortunately, we tried to set it up earlier, but we had technical.
Can you forward those files to us?
I forwarded the files to you, yes, but I wanted to be able to show you what we talked about. I did. Or
everyone has them in their.
The chair
forwarded with the agenda. Yeah.
Oh, for the file.
In email.
Exactly. Yeah.
I thought it was a document.
So should we just pass them around real quickly?
Sure.
So just in here, this is the one, this is the LED retrofit, and this is the old high-pressure sodium. And it actually shows two things. You can actually see how it actually does provide a cutoff. So the light, the amount of light going up is less. It's not 100% cutoff. It's definitely not 100% cutoff. This one, the light going up is, you know, really quite washes up high of the wall. But the lighting level, it's kind of a judgment call. I think that, you know, being there, it actually looks like the LED is just slightly brighter than the high pressure sodium.
Are you in a question place yet?
Are you ready to?
I think I'm pretty much covered.
Questions at this point.
Yeah. Right. I mean, the last question will be, if we feel like going with a different lamp and not just doing an upgrade, that's probably going to cost more. And so where does the money come from? That's the last big question.
That is the big question.
Yes.
So that kind of answered the question I was going to ask, because at some point I lost track of whether you were asking us about the purchase of actual new fixtures or just the lights to put in the old fixtures. My understanding, though, is that if we put these new bulbs that you're recommending into the current fixtures, that we're actually losing some of the savings, as it were, because we're losing some of the luminosity, because the fixtures aren't made for those bulbs. Is that correct?
No. We would possibly shorten the lifetime of the light engine. I don't want to call it a bulb because it's not a bulb, but we would possibly lose, because it's not designed thermally to fit with that fixture. But because the light is all going down, any of these fixtures, the light would basically come out.
I want to amend that. I actually think you're right. Lisa, you would be losing a lot of light. As Chris mentioned, because the original proposal would be to replace an existing light engine inside a fixture with a different light engine inside the same fixture, and because that fixture has a glass globe. Which is not clear, but it gets dirty, it changes color, it's actually acrylic, it changes color with age and infrared and ultraviolet radiation. It actually takes a lot of the light that was coming down from the new fancy light engine you put in and casts it straight up into the sky, straight into your eyes, into the eyes of drivers and pedestrians and cyclists, not down where we want it. And furthermore, the whole design of the light itself sitting on top of a post, you can't even get light going straight down because there's a post in the way. So the fixture completely prevents actual downlighting that we want. And so that's why Chris is here today to discuss, can we consider alternatives that would be better, which I wholeheartedly endorse.
You've mentioned lighting cycle, but you have never told me what you expect it to be for the new fixtures, not the light engine in our old fixtures, but the entire new fixture.
Oh, the new fixtures? Okay, one of the reasons why I'm bringing this here first is that before I did any kind of research, and it's going to take a bit of research, calling around, getting quotes and stuff to get a pricing and specs on a new fixture, when it wasn't even sure if the city would want a new fixture, I haven't really done any of that research. I wanted to have a good idea if this is the direction we want to go in before I did that. Typically, LEDs last 70 to 100,000 hours. They're long-lasting lights, far longer than high-pressure sodium or
Ned, do you remember, I mean, lifespan of high-pressure sodium is, yeah. They're just far, far longer lasting. I mean, that's one of the advantages of them.
Here's an LED that is rated for 25,000 hours.
Okay, that's a low one, because they're typically 70 to 100,000 hours is what you would see. And I'm pretty sure the one that we were recommended was 100,000 hours, maybe 70,000 hours.
I would like to just I'm slow. My light bulb is complicated, but well, it's actually I
takes a while to get your head around this one.
To take a step back and frame the actual discussion here, because there's a lot of technical information here, yeah, which is good for us to sort through. But what there is a city grant, if I understand you, to replace X amount of actual posts.
No, animals. Just the light bulb.
Just the light bulbs. Okay.
Just the light bulb. The light engine. Whoops.
So that is what you intend to do, right?
That's what I have.
New engines.
That's what I have money to do.
Okay.
That's what I would like to do within a year, so that I'm eligible for future grants.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how many? I'm asking like a bunch of basic questions, real quick.
Okay. 140. Well, no, 150 lights.
Okay. And forgive me if you've already said this in the course of your exposition, but. And so, what you're coming to us because what are we weighing in on? Exactly?
Okay, I don't
the locations.
If I had just gotten the grant, put out a bid, and done this, and this would have been done. But with the considerations that Mr. Thelenthal brought up, and walking it around, thinking that maybe we can get some additional energy savings. And just being responsive to, you know, the citizens, there were some concerns, but in order to address those concerns, I would either or both have to replace the whole fixture, mm-hmm, not just the bulb, mm-hmm, or go with the dimmer lights in order to get the color light that some people might find more comfortable, mm-hmm, without going up in wattage. So when I talked about changing light intensity, mm-hmm, or changing the entire lamp, which I didn't have money for, nor would I have, it's not up to me to decide what style lights we have out there. That's where I needed broader input from the community. And I did bring this before the Energy Commission and also here, looking for some kind of broader input. Can I go this direction?
You picked the wrong group if you want questions, advice on style. Thanks, Mr. Lothal, and then Councilor.
Well, as you know, I went to Sunlight to put together a presentation, which unfortunately we can't do unless we have.
Yeah, again, I apologize. We tried to set up a projector.
But would you indulge me in walking through it and discussing, because I think it will address many questions that are likely to come up.
Please.
So, actually, my presentation is over. My one printout is right there. So. This is going to take. I'm going to step back a little bit and stepping back, and a brief primer on why this matters on outdoor light concepts. So first of all, I want to say thank you, Chris, so much for all the work that you've done in saving the city so much energy, which all of us agree is a good idea. And
not to mention a grant.
And getting a grant, and then taking the time furthermore to engage in this conversation just abroad, that you thought you were ready to go with what seemed like an obviously good thing, and then I came along and said, hang on, there's more to it. As you know, I'm a professional astronomer. This is the issue we care about more than almost any other. I recommend this book if you want to read any more than I'm telling you right now. There are three main concepts that bear directly on the issue Chris is talking about that have to do with outdoor lighting. The light should go down only. Down only. That's where the subject is that we're trying to light. None of it should go out, and certainly none of it should go up. Warm colors are better than cool colors. What that means is sort of towards the red and yellow end of the spectrum rather towards the blue. And the reason for that is when your eyes are dark adapted, when they're mesopic or scotopic, a blue light ruins the dark adaptation. There's also accruing evidence that blue light is harmful for wildlife and for humans at night. Finally, the lighting should not be brighter than necessary. There's increasing evidence, again, for the harmful effects of overlighting, which includes some of these. The sky gets artificially bright. You can't see
the natural beauty of the night sky. There are health effects, again, on animals and humans, and there are safety effects. So especially how this relates to transportation and parking commission is that the great majority of lighting, outdoor lighting, is the city's outdoor lighting for streets and parking lots. And it's there for safety reasons, and we do a lousy job of it. So the bottom line is that the design of the lighting matters very, very much. The amount of the lighting can go way, way down if the design of the lighting is better. So what we have generally, by and large, is bad lighting. Lighting like this, unshielded. So what Mr. Mason keeps referring to as 100% cutoff, what that means is that the light should be in a can here like this, so that it goes down only. And cutoff means that that the line 90 degrees from the vertical is the highest that the light gets. It's cut, if it tries to go out, it's cut off at that level. So Northampton's outdoor lighting regulation requires that all light be full cutoff, which is a good thing. However, that's not necessarily good enough, and we can do better. This would be the worst, right? Here's a light that's just a round ball where the light, in fact, goes more up than down because the post is on the way down. This is the worst possible. Here is a street light in Northampton in my neighborhood at Round Hill and Hillside that you can see from blocks and blocks and blocks away. The rule of thumb is if you can see the light from anywhere except directly underneath it, it's insufficiently shielded. And you're doing several bad things. One, you're wasting energy, because if the light is going very far out, it's not doing anybody any good at all. But it blinds you by providing glare. So glare is light shining directly in your eyes without any of the benefit. And here's an example. So you can all see my face pretty well right now, right? But if I do this, I mean, can you see my face? No, of course not. So has the lighting in the room changed at all? No, the light level is exactly the same in the room, but you have glare that blinds you. So if instead I had done this, you know, you can still see my face fine. That's what we should be doing with all outdoor lighting. So now when you go out at night, ask yourself, can I see the light from far away or not? If you can see it from far away, it's no good. What you should see instead is something like this. Here's a little diagram showing bad, you know, a little bit better, not so bad, and much better. The best, where the light goes down only. And an example of that would be here at Smith College, which has recently been putting a lot of time and effort into correcting their bad outdoor lights. Here, you can't see the light at all, as opposed to this, where all you see is the fixture itself. Here you don't see the fixture, you see the nice soft glow of the stuff underneath the fixture.
James, can I interrupt really
Please.
Quickly? A really real-life example that's affecting residents in Northampton. I get calls all the time, I don't know if you get them, but people saying to me, can you please tell the DPW to shine the light in a different direction? What they don't get is that it's this, it's the positionality of the light, it's not the... And so we're getting a lot of calls from residents that are really concerned that it's shining in their windows.
Just want to mention, you're probably referring to streetlights, I assume, right? Okay. Just the city is looking at upgrading streetlights to LEDs, yeah. But I think it's a good idea to keep that conversation separate,
yeah.
Because it's one more big thing that can make this even more confusing. So,
okay.
So right now we're talking about just the post tops, the decorative ornamentals down there.
You'll find on this page, I won't go through them all, but these are examples of good and bad. And you know, fully shielded, full cutoff, fully shielded means, you know, what we just said, the light is in a can, the shield prevents the light from going out sideways or up. The next page likewise has some bad and good examples. Here is an example of what a decorative post-top lamp could look like that is fully shielded. The light is going down only, and there's no diffusing dusty, dirty, yellow acrylic around it to take the light and send it upwards. Here is the example from Smith College. It is a light in a can. It's an inverted bowl made of opaque metal. The light can go down only. It does a beautiful job of illuminating the things underneath it without any glare at all. And this is a 13-watt bulb. So Chris is talking about replacing 100 and how much watts, high-pressure sodium, with 55-watt LEDs. This is a 13-watt LED that does a beautiful job. So as Chris mentioned, this is an opportunity, possibly, for additional savings.
The point would be that 13-watt bulb would be far dimmer.
Fine, so it could be a 25-watt bulb.
Not an apples comparison, just to let you know.
This is a discussion about the different warm versus cool colors. Warm for us, the numbers go backwards because warm actually refers to things that have, a warm color means redder, but that's actually the lower temperature. The temperature of a light should be less than 3,000 degrees Kelvin. Did I pull that out of my hat? No. This is the number that is recommended by the International Dark Sky Association, which is the largest nonprofit that is devoted to this issue. 3,000 or less. This one is 3,000 degrees Kelvin. The ones that are being installed willy-nilly around the country right now are often 5,000 degrees Kelvin. It's a much bluer light, much, much bluer. Now, here in Davis, California, when they tried this, people complained so much about it that the city put the brakes on and said, okay, we'll test. And they put in some warm, medium, and cool, or 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 degree Kelvin. Everybody preferred the warmer ones. Time and time again, this is what studies have shown. Yes, it's true, as Chris said, the higher temperature, 5,000 bluer ones, they tend to show the colors. It's more like daylight, but it's harder on your eyes. It causes more glare. And there's another problem, another unwanted side effect, which is that, remember, 30% of the light going down bounces up into the sky anyway. And blue light scatters much more in the atmosphere, which is why the daytime sky is blue. This means that even if we save energy, we're going to make light pollution worse. Light pollution meaning the brightness of the sky. So how bad a problem is this? Here is a picture of downtown Northampton with this light pollution on the left here. And here is a picture with the same exposure, just 10 miles from here in Waitley, where you have dark skies, you can see the stars and the Milky Way, and all of this is from streetlights. And much of it is from streetlight that's bouncing off the pavement and concrete and so on. And that could potentially get worse if we put in lights that are too blue. Here is a map showing Northampton's, showing the brightness of the sky, and that red spot in the middle, that's Northampton. So we'd like to reduce that, not make it worse. So here's a picture that Chris referred to outside La Fiorentina, showing these two lampposts, both with the acorn-style light. This is the one with the original high-pressure sodium. This is the one with the retrofit that's in the grant currently. And what I'd like to point out is that I'm way across the street, a block away, and you can see this light very, very clearly. You shouldn't see it at all, right? The reason for that is even though the LED started out going down, as I said, they got caught by this dirty acrylic globe and sent out in all directions. And so this would not be consistent with our current Northampton ordinance. We're retrofitting new lights we're putting lipstick on a pig, basically. I think it's the wrong, we would never buy this fixture now. It would not be consistent with our own city ordinance. More examples from the current police station here outside the police station. The chief knows my concerns about this. These lights were put in after our ordinance went into effect. These are not consistent with the ordinance either. These are up on the top parking deck of the police station. You can see the light is going out in all directions. That doesn't help anybody. It wastes energy. It blinds drivers, pedestrians, cyclists, especially old people, and it ruins the view of the night sky.
That's how I get my drones in without any.
So right next to it, also part of the garage, are some great examples. So the lights on the side here are fully shielded, and they're fantastic. And they're warm color, 3,000 degrees or less. They're beautiful. They're effective. They light the subject underneath. They don't blind anybody. No glare. No light pollution. And low wattage. That's exactly what we want. So it can be done. There are good samples out there. This is an alternative, which Chris already knows about, an alternative light engine to the one he suggested, which is a warmer color. So that's better. This one, is, as you pointed out, is not actually on that list.
That one actually is on the list.
Oh, good. Okay.
But
the AmeroLux.
But it's about half the lumens than the one that was recommended. Right. So again, if you want to get to the low warmer color,
right,
you have to reduce light output.
Okay.
Yeah, that one you have now that you're looking at.
This one.
Which I actually like that style myself personally, but that's not on the list. Right.
Right. But there are hundreds long by multiple dozens of manufacturers.
As many as you think.
So maybe not dozens. So finally, this last question, is more light always better? So of the three points I made, one was the light should go down only. It should be fully shielded from glare. Two, the color should be warmer, not cooler, less than 3,000 degrees Kelvin. And three, it should be as low as possible. Now, this may seem counterintuitive. We've been raised in a culture that thinks we have to push back the night with more light. But there's a, I would say the tide is changing in that view, and there are cities across the country now that are committing themselves to making their streets and communities perfectly safe, but keeping the sky dark. So what's the right amount of light? If more light is better, we should just always have more light. What's the right level? There are standards. There's the Illuminating Engineering Society of America, of North America, which has guidelines for these things. And most of our parking lots are well above that, those levels. So there are standard levels for illumination. And this is also in our city ordinance. And most of our existing lighting is well in excess of that. You can talk about it in terms of foot candles. And if you go out and measure the foot candles under a dim street light, so right here, I turn this on and I measure. So foot candles is a measure of the brightness. And right here I'm getting, this is about 50 foot candles. About 1 foot candle is plenty bright for most street and parking lot situations. Some super bright lights in town give as much as, you know, 5 or 6 foot candles. That's way more than we need. We could go to 1/2 foot candle and still see fine. The point being that if you get rid of the glare, then you can go with much lower levels. If once you have glare, whether it's just blinding you, then there's an immediate reaction. I can't see. We need more light. But the problem is that the design is the problem, which is why Chris has brought this before us. I will just say the bottom line from my perspective is we should definitely, in my view, not just retrofit the existing acorn lamps. We should be looking at better lighting for Northampton. I think the city deserves it. And we're looking at an investment that's gonna last us 20 to 30 years, and we should make the right decision. We should make something that is beautiful for the city, that serves safety, and that is effective and efficient. And I think that means new designs of lightings, not retrofitting.
So I want to bring up 2 points of perspective. I think everything James is saying, it makes a lot of sense, but the two things I'll say is that the amount of blue in the lights that we're looking at is about less than 20% of the total light. So when you're talking about increasing the amount of light that goes up in the sky, on the high pressure sodiums, I mean, the amount of lumens coming out is about 3 times less than the current lamps that are in there, and only about 20% of that light is blue.
But that 20% is very important, as
okay.
I said.
I couldn't tell you how much more, but it's, you know,
I can tell you exactly how much more.
We're definitely, I mean, we're really reducing the amount of light just by going this way. We're reducing the amount of light that we're actually producing. And the second piece is with James, we measured the foot candles underneath one of the lights at La Florentina. And it actually had some light coming out of the window of La Florentina too. We tried blocking it as much as possible, but we got about 1/2 foot candle, a little bit more.
I redid that after Fiorentino was closed.
Oh, good. Yeah. What did you get?
I'll look it up.
Okay.
Okay.
But it's about 1/2 foot candle, so it's not one of the brighter areas. So.
Well, I mean, are there any questions?
I need some more time to digest this.
Yeah.
I mean, I know you included, you know, more light's better with Philadelphia, et cetera, but, you know, perception is 90% of the issues when it comes to crime prevention. People feel unsafe in darker areas. I don't know how much darker, if we're going to reduce the lumens, the output, how that's going to affect people's feeling of safety. But certainly think there's a balance to look at what you're talking about in a manner that could satisfy the perception of people and also reduce the light. I don't know, by retrofitting or if these lamps, because everything's going down, if suddenly your footprint of your light leads people from light areas to dark areas to light areas to dark areas when they're walking, which could be a difficulty for some people. I don't know, because the lamps are so spread out, if you do this down lighting, do we now need double the lights to cover the gaps? Questions I have. And then one of the issues that we deal with, particularly with the sodium lights, is witnesses to crimes, etc., the color interpretation. You know, a blue shirt turns green, a gray car turns blue, and because the color's reflecting off these different, the light reflecting off these different colors give you a whole different perception of what the color is. So I don't know what the differentiation between the blue lights, the white lights, the warmer lights, how that affects a witness's visual or a victim's visual interpretation of the clues that we need when we're dealing with a crime.
Can I address the last question first? Or Chris, do you want to address these?
I would like to ask just a quick question first. I mean, I think it's a fascinating discussion, and I think we'll go on for a long time, and perhaps we should.
Don't we always? I skip swimming.
I guess what I want to figure out is, what is actually the decision point? I don't even know what we're weighing exactly yet. So really, and I think it's we could come back to this in a future agenda, unless there's an urgency here. So my question is, what's our goal today?
So the decision,
let's have an appropriate level of more conversation to meet that goal.
Right. That's why I wanted to bring it down to kind of a decision point is, you know, trying to get rid of a lot of the fluff is it okay to change styles of lights? And if so, what styles are appropriate? What style of lamp? And are there places where it's okay to reduce light output? You know, have something that feels less bright. So those are the two things that I would say, those are the main questions to focus on. Because then all the details around that can be worked out by what's available.
No. Are any of these lights governed by the historic district or anything like that, and changing the heads out?
Not that I can.
As far as the appearance of them?
No, none of them are. I don't believe any of them are in the historic district.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm going to venture. We're not going to vote on this, but so I'm just going to take a chance to sort of give you a first blush on what I think about it, which is I really care a lot about the color balance. I really want a warm light. It matters. I mean, your assignment is energy, but I've been in towns where it has been the issue to replace these and get these very different feeling lights. And second, because they do last 20, 25 years, I think we ought to err on the side of putting in the best system we can identify because of that life cycle. So that's kind of where I am.
The project that James referred to is a project that I did
at Smith
College. And, the difference between we put in a 2700 Kelvin LED, and it replaced a 100 watt high-pressure sodium. So the quality of light actually was vastly improved. And not all of the fixtures we have are true full cutoff. But one of the lamp itself, the LED lamp itself, is diffused. So it's like a frosted lens. Whereas the high-pressure sodium lamp was more like literally a glass bulb that had a very sharp point, and you could see that hot spot, and so the glare level was very high. So when we did some mock-ups, we just replaced lamps. We did them down by, we did one on Lamont Bridge, and we did several crosses in the river at the athletic field. So there was very little competition from lights built from buildings, so you could really see the difference, and people could hardly tell there was a difference. What they saw was an improvement in light. They didn't see that there was lower light. If you measured it with a light meter, the lumens were down, no question about it. But the perception was it was very good. They actually thought there was an improvement. So it can work. I think when you're in a city environment, and the higher you go, the harder it is to deal with glare. But glare is the culprit. So I think if we were to do this without replacing the fixtures, you'd be losing something that's worth having, and that's getting rid of the glare.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? I'm still not sure exactly what we vote on. One idea to float to all of you is, I don't want to make this more complicated than it has to be, but it's like we're talking about locations, we're talking about fixtures, we're talking about types of light. I mean, we could vote to form a small ad hoc group that looks at all this stuff for our commission from our perspective and come back at a later time, or we could carry it to next meeting, because otherwise I feel like this is a long conversation with lots of detail in it.
One thing we might do is just say that as a commission, we recognize that most outdoor lighting in Northampton is directly related to transportation because it's on streets and parking lots, and that the leaving aside the aesthetics, which I don't think we should, but if we do that, we can still say, just from a safety perspective, that we endorse high quality light above all, which means low glare, well designed lighting, and that is very important for safety. And so maybe this commission could just endorse the principle that for us, that the quality of the light is an important one from the safety, from a transportation safety perspective.
Is there a question here before you introduce it?
Are there other committees involved in this? DPW have any say, or BPW have any say in this?
We found it in new streets with subdivision rules and regulations, so that'd be planning board and DPW weighing in on that.
That would be new construction.
Right.
The Energy and Sustainability Commission tried to bat this around as well. And they didn't have a resolution either. They didn't vote on anything. But the sense I had was they would support lower wattage. They didn't feel they were in a position to weigh in on light levels or color. Or whether you replace the fixtures or not. I mean, their mandate is probably narrower than yours. And what was the last, kind of sum up what they, without any kind of formal vote, this is not something formally voted on, but it wasn't that hopeful. It's not an easy, like I said, it's a complicated piece.
One other possibility is we could just vote to continue this conversation to the next meeting.
It seems to me, I mean, we could take some kind of vote that theoretically we support these two questions that Chris has posed to us, but to me what makes more sense is if, Chris, you could maybe in conjunction with James or perhaps an ad hoc committee create some sort of recommendations that you want our support, our yay or nay for, so that we're not kind of voting on all this information and unclear questions. So I'd like to see us receive actual recommendations that we can then consider, have more conversation about, and make and submit a vote on. I mean, one of the things, just on a very practical level, I'd like to know more about what kind of state rebates we have possible. Is there any kind of federal, what are we talking about here in terms of money as well? So there's a lot more information I think we need along with the recommendation to actually be able to weigh in on this.
Okay.
I think that makes sense, just especially given our this is the process and our time constraints today.
Right. I would be happy to work with a few other folks, but the one skill or knowledge that I would like to have on that is if we go with something besides what I have money for, where do we get the extra money? You know, I want to know, because if there is no other money for this, then my hands are tied. I basically have to do the retrofit as I got a grant for.
That was a question. I mean, if we start replacing fixtures, is it outside the scope of your grant?
It's outside the scope of my office, that's for sure. No, I think the grant would be fine with that as long as I didn't go up in wattage, as long as I save the energy that's, that I said I was going to save.
Yeah.
If I put in a different fixture, but it saved just as much energy, they would be fine with that.
That's why I included.
And, how many fixtures would you get versus how many download at the same price?
I'd have to address the same number of lights. I mean, I'd have to get the same amount of total energy savings. So, I think
so
it really
be replacing fewer lights if we're replacing fixtures than if we're just replacing the bulbs.
Yes, but can I interject here?
Well,
I couldn't change the grant that way. I would like to
amend the kind of recommendation I made that we get a recommendation, because I think that we do need to make a decision about theoretically, do we support this? Are we committed as a city to doing things that are gonna improve, downgrade the amount of light that we're projecting into the atmosphere? Are we saving money? Are we being more energy conscious? All of that. So that's the kind of recommendation I think that we need to get, and we'll worry about how it's going to be funded later. I think it's beyond our purview anyway.
I agree. I would like to suggest that we make a motion to ask James to write a one-page recommendation and bring it to us next meeting. I think we've received a lot of good background and had a lot of good discussion today, but I agree Councilor Klein that at a certain point we do need to vote on specifics, and that's the way to do it, in my opinion. Then you can liaise with Chris Mason if that works for you two. Then we'll have something in front of us that we can
identify money.
And I'll try and find some money,
Way home. Well, if there's energy savings, couldn't that pay for it? I mean, for we're saving energy over the next 30 years, it certainly
it's a factor as well.
The fixtures.
Okay. So I'd like to call to...
So the Energy Commission didn't weigh in on that. We'll be saving, I mean, even if we go with it as the grant is written, we'll be saving $12,000 to $13,000 a year. The Energy Commission felt that that was a reasonable thing to use that money to pay for, to think of that as paying back whatever the city pays above and beyond the grant.
I'd like to also thank you for coming and spending this much time. And I think we'll wrap up this conversation for now, if it's okay with everyone. And that's what we'll expect from James's recommendation.
You made a motion.
Okay.
To have James do it. Is there a second?
I second that.
Okay, all in favor?
I think we've had enough discussion.
Absolutely. All right, very good. So that's what we'll do. Thank you very much. Hey, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? I can't imagine. Abstain?
James, maybe you should abstain because you're up to do it.
Okay, I'm not going to.
Yeah. It's okay, James abstains. Thank you very much. Now, the state of play here is it is 6 o'clock. Does anyone come in this room at 6 o'clock? Do we lose this room? Well, I guess we'll find out.
6 o'clock.
We have six items. We have six items left. Let's go through as quickly as possible. I did want to talk about number one. I think this is important for us. We receive multiple requests from residents to change parking spots, either where they live or whatever. And it could be we want a new parking space there, or we want to get rid of one because it blocks me getting out of my driveway and so forth. Just as we have a traffic calming application, my suggestion that I've written up here is that we adopt a policy that is similar with regards to these requests, so that when we get them, we can send them through a normal process, so people feel they've been heard and have had a fair process. What I suggest here is basically that we establish the criteria we use to make these decisions, and that we send it, first to the parking committee to answer some of them, and if we choose to go forward with it, we consider further criteria in consultation with the DPW and other relevant players. So that's what this policy describes. I would love your feedback on it. And if you feel prepared to vote to endorse it, that would also be something that would be good. But, would love to discuss that.
I have a commitment at 6:15, so.
Okay.
You lose your quorum.
No, you won't lose your quorum.
Mike. I love you. I've been frustrated with the traffic calming process. I've written about it, I think creating yet another one worries me in that regard, because people come in, they think you're going to do something, and often I think they just started the process. But now that's why I would never be representative or counselor. It's almost a sort of a sneaking feeling that I have, that we're enticing people to think we're going to fix things when sometimes we know already, and it's better to get a straight answer. But so I'm not sure. I just want to recognize that's what I think we would be doing, is creating more of a process, which, you all could say, yep, that's a good idea, we should do it. I certainly had people fuss at me about parking slots. I mean, it's we've heard from people in my neighborhood. There's another one that's I get a call on every couple of weeks. So, I could bring you the first one if you all decide you want to go that way.
Any other thoughts?
You'll have your corner.
Is there any chance we can
good luck with your drums, Chief.
More of these conversations, I suspect.
You want to table the rest of the
agenda? I actually think this is a very interesting discussion, and I think that Devin's bringing up some really important points, but I think it really warrants a lot more discussion, and if we're trying to race through them, I just don't think we're going to do it justice.
Okay, so So are you making a motion to continue all the other, all these six?
Unless there's anything that has real time urgency, I think that we should, I would make a motion, but I just want to look through it.
I would be fine with that, frankly.
I mean, is there anything here as the chair that you feel like we need to address today?
Well, I really wanted to address the, you know, how we handle parking requests, because we continue to get them, and I think we need a uniform policy to deal with them. But I'm happy to defer to the commission if we want to continue these six or five items to next time. That's fine. Does anyone have any objection to that? Okay. So Councilor Klein has made the motion. I will second it. And if there's no discussion, all in favor of continuing them?
Opposed?
Abstained? Okay. Any new business? Who would like to make a motion to adjourn? Don't all rush. Devin?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.